architecture returns, which is basically investing in a generational stock. I will explain to you what a generational stock is later. And secondly, I'm also gonna tell you about investing in basically counters that are like stress-free, that gives you maybe like 5 to 10% annual return on average. And the first one is a US stock, the second one is a Malaysian stock. So just a little bit of background about myself. So it sounds like I'm a little bit more credible, right? So basically, I was an institutional trader. I was a fund manager last time for CIMB. I was managing about $1 billion asset under management for CIMB, and I was doing that for about 8 to 9 years, right? After I kind of like get off from CIMB, right now I am running some family offices, means I'm managing some family funds, and I invest in startups, some private equities, some bonds, equities, and so on, and so on. And currently I'm also part of this stock pit management team. I'll share with you what stock pit is later on. So contents about what we are not going to do today. What I'm not going to do today is basically talk about the timing of the market, because I know that the market has been very bad, right? When to buy, when to sell, when basically I was very lucky to be able to sell most of my holdings just before the big drop on Monday. And what I'm not going to do also is I'm not going to tell you on how to make money in the stock market during a bad time. So for instance, I'm not going to explain to you how you can short the shares of like Royal Caribbean, Boeing, Wind, Booking during bad times like the coronavirus and take advantage of that. What I would like to explain to you and what I would like to share with you is more on a long-term investment concept. An investment concept which is to invest in generational stock, and also to have in your portfolio to invest or to kind of like hedge with a strong defensive counter that has high dividend yield. On the second one, it's a Malaysian counter. So it's also one of my top picks for Malaysia in 2020 to balance off the kind of like aggressive portfolio that people normally have in the equity market. All right. So first and foremost, what is generational stock? Is it stocks for Gen Ys, stocks for Gen Zs? Maybe, right? But I think I would personally prefer to explain a generational stock as if investing in those stocks that makes its mark in the world. So stocks such as Ford when we were in 1918s or 1910s, right? Or investing in recently, basically investing in like or like maybe around 1950s you invest in insurance companies, or in 1990s you invest in some sort of like internet companies. So these are stocks that has made a huge impact in that generation. Okay, so I have two regrets in my life. When I started investing in 2004, I was about 16 years old then, right? So my father is basically, he's quite a stock market fanatic as well, right? So in 2004, when I go to my IT classes, they teach you about how to use Google, right? Then I'm like, hey, this Google is going public, you know, like, maybe it's not a bad idea because I use it everywhere, right? And then I'm like, I was telling my father, like, why don't we invest in Google? Why don't you invest in Google, right? And he's like, what is this nonsense technology stocks trading at like crazy valuations? I don't even understand the business, right? It's probably going to be like another dot-com bubble nonsense that's going to fail. Okay, so that's my regret number one. And my regret number two is that in 2008, I did not invest in Apple, right? So basically in 2008, as you all know, it was like a presentation from Steve Jobs saying that this iPhone, right? And then I was like, wow, I was so taken aback with it. I'm like, this is so cool. Like, I can see this, I can see everybody using this. You know, that during that time, even Apple already had the iPods. And everybody basically have iPods in their pocket. It's like music, it's like thousands of music in your pocket, right? It was like revolutionary. And then Steve Jobs came with iPhone, even more revolutionary. And then I'm like, okay, I want to invest in this. But then I didn't invest in it. So it's my second biggest regret in life. Why didn't I invest in it? Because I read books like this. Secrets of Millionaire by Adam Kuhn. Fundamental analysis, fundamental analysis, fundamental analysis. Oh, there are 12 steps that you need to follow for you to buy a stock. Step 1, step 2, step 3, and then step 12. Step 1, make sure that you invest in companies that have historically revenues going up, profit going up, ROE of 12%, free cash flow, this, that. Fundamental analysis was important for Adam Kuhn and basically, and for a lot of other like gurus out there, right? And I wouldn't blame them because I personally, when I started investing, these are the kind of like principles that I hold here in order for me to start investing, right? But the thing is, if you follow this 100%, you are always going to miss out on the multi-baggers. Always going to miss out on the multi-baggers. You are never going to be able to see or you're never going to be able to invest in companies that is going to give you 10x in a span of a few years. Alright? Because basically, fundamental analysis that is being taught theoretically and historically by a lot of gurus out there is that you have to learn about value. You have to learn about basically debt to equity ratio and your risk, your margin of safety. But again, sometimes you need to take a step back, you need to take a step aside, because right now we are at the kind of like, we are actually at a place and at a time whereby growth is exponential. Means growth is something that everybody is going to look out for. Okay? So the past is not the future. And the most important thing is basically your ability to be able to see and measure the growth. Which is going to be the key for you to identify what is going to be the next generational stock. What is going to be the next stock that is going to really revamp the whole market and how the world is going to look at things. So basically, what is a generational stock, in my opinion, that exists in the market right now? In my opinion, is Tesla. So this is a counter that I have been buying since 2018, and the approach of me doing this is that I'm doing a dollar cost averaging. I buy Tesla with my money, my salary. So I get a salary from Stockbit. It's a $3,000 every single month. But I also have salary from my other businesses, right? So every single month when I get money in Stockbit, I straight away buy Tesla shares. Every single month. Why do I do that? Because I believe in this company. I believe this is going to be the next generational company. Also, another kind of like just an info. I used to be a shop. I used to be a Tesla shop. I used to think this company fundamentally doesn't make sense. It always asks money from the shareholders, and it is not giving me kind of like it doesn't give me results. So it's just that in 2018, when they released their Q3 result, that in my opinion was basically the turnaround. On when I feel this company can be sustainable in the future. And I was actually talking about this on LinkedIn's course, I think last year. I think that time was very funny. The stock was trading at, it was I think in July of 2019, the stock was trading at like 180 or something like that. I was like losing about 30 to 40%, right? Then I told LinkedIn, hey, don't worry, like, just keep investing in it, no problem. And then at the beginning of this year, when the stock was trading at 900, I got messages every single day from everyone. It's like, hey, Tesla, cancel buy today. I'm like, when it was like 500, I said, yeah, I can buy, just buy. 600, it's like, yeah, I can buy still. 700, I'm like, just buy, just do a dollar averaging. You know, just do what I do. Do the dollar averaging, because This is one for the future. If you want to trade this for the short term, then don't do it. But if you would like a stock that you can always carry until you are, maybe like 30 years old or 40 years old, maybe that is 25 or 36, I don't know what. Until you're 40 or 35, let's just say 35, buy a Tesla. And I'm going to explain to you why I feel like this is a generational stock that is worth investing for you. Now, everybody has a different kind of like analysis, okay? But this is just my personal pick. You might have your own different generational stock that you might unearth. Please share with me next time. Share with me, text out and take and share with me. Then I can do analysis on it. But I have done thorough analysis of Tesla, and I feel like this is the stock. This is basically my champion on how I'm going to do my dollar cost averaging method. So for me right now, I have two things that I'm doing in dollar cost averaging. One is I'm investing in S&P 500 every single month. Right now it's down and crazy. I don't want to see. But secondly, I'm still buying it. So secondly, the second stock is I invest in Tesla. So even when it was like 800 something, I was buying it in January. When it was like 700 something in February, I was buying it. Next year, this 1st of March, I just bought it. 1st of April, I'm going to buy it again. That's my approach of investment. And I feel like it's an investment approach that, if I look back, has actually helped to create my personal wealth. Not that I'm wealthy, but it has actually made me kind of like quite comfortable on where I am at the moment. Okay, so now I'm going to put here for Tesla, the road to 1 trillion. Just mind you, today, very similar to like your Lotus, like the Lotus car, right? And that is because what he used to do is he take many parts of different cars and he assembled them to be an electric car. Okay, so that's what happens in 2008. And in 2008, everybody was laughing at Elon Musk. He was like saying, this is gonna fail. Electric vehicle is never gonna make it, right? But fast forward to now, every single car manufacturers out there right now, your BMW, your Mercedes, your Porsche, they are trying to get a piece of electric vehicle. Okay, next. They got listed, I think, in 2011. In 2012, they came up with a Tesla Model S. Oh, by the way, for you to understand Tesla cars, there is only three Tesla cars in the market right now. They come up with the Model S first, then Model X, and Model 3. So it's like sexy, right? They're coming up with Model Y soon. So it's like sexy. So it's easy for you to understand the models of Tesla cars. Okay, so in 2012, they come up with Model S. And basically, Model S is also a 300 miles range of electric vehicle, means one full charge of electric vehicle, you can drive 300 miles. That is basically the range, okay? But the difference in 2012 is that this Model S, unlike in 2008, where it's like different cars and it's being assembled together, in 2012, Model S is created in-house in a factory in the US, okay? It is being designed and built from scratch by Tesla themselves. And after that, they continue their vertical integration. They build more and more factories in the US. And in 2018, right now, this is just released, the Tesla Model 3, and it costs $40,000. It is still a 300 miles range electric vehicle, and it's basically the combination of years of vertical integration and production now. So between the 2012 to 2018, Tesla has gone through a lot of production hell, and which is why the stock market always comes up and then comes down. Then come up, it never goes up because production are very, very difficult. When Elon Musk says, I'm going to produce 100,000 cars, it always falls short, okay? By 2018, every single thing of the particular Model 3 car is owned by Tesla, from the car to the battery, everything, okay? What can you see from 2008 to 2018 is that they always bring down the cost, and it is always going to be more and more accessible for the mass market. So the master plan for basically Tesla is that they plan to really kind of like make the world move away from your normal fossil fuel cars into an electric car, to adopt electric vehicle. Okay, and now Tesla is not just a car company. This is the thing that a lot of analysts in the Wall Street do not understand. They are not just a car company. Tesla is actually computer on wheels. So just like Apple last time, when they actually kind of like revolutionized phone to make phone as a computer, Tesla is doing the same thing. Tesla is now making car as a computer. It unlocks value because why? Now, whenever you want to value Tesla, you can't value it because it's just a car company. Because now you need to value it as a car company and a tech company. And basically, this is basically Mark Hogan's CEO saying that the next step of kind of a digital revolution will be that all the cars are going to have internet. Okay, now, basically this is a little bit of fundamentals, so bear with me, okay? On the top left over there, and on the top left, on the bottom left over here, you see that every single year, Tesla always hit record sales of number of cars, alright? And in 2019, just passed, they managed to sell 367,000 of Tesla cars. Okay, in 2020, they project they're going to be able to make and sell 500,000 electric vehicles. Alright. And then on the top right, Tesla is basically the top selling electric vehicle. And you can see, right? You're number one, you're number two, and you're number four. They are all Tesla cars. There is no other electric vehicle in the US that comes anywhere as near as Tesla. So Tesla dominates the EV market in the US. I wish I had the global data, but that is not very easy to find. Alright? They have actually 80% of the market share. And people have been talking about Tesla killers. They say like, oh, the Audi is gonna kill Tesla, the Volkswagen is gonna kill Tesla, the BMW is gonna kill Tesla, the Porsche is gonna kill Tesla, Jaguar is gonna kill Tesla. But up until today, nobody actually has come anywhere close to Tesla. And on the bottom right, this is basically, this is a little bit technical, right? Basically, in electric vehicle, you need to come up with this thing called the electric vehicle skateboard. It's like a computer chip. And basically, Tesla's skateboard, if you can see from here, is just simply way ahead. There are all S over here, which is the 2012 model, right? It still has the better range than, for instance, the latest electric vehicle that comes up, which is not Tesla, which is from Porsche. The Porsche Taycan. Porsche Taycan is selling at $200,000. And it has only a range of 250 miles. Means your full battery of a Porsche Taycan can only last you 250 miles. Your full battery of a Model 3, or rather even like your 2012 Tesla car, is even more than that. So the technology in 2012 for Tesla is better than the technology of 2020 from Porsche. That's how good they are, right? Core efficiency rating, basically, this is the amount of battery that is required to cover that range. So, as you can see, Tesla dominates the core efficiency rating, means there is less battery and more range. So, because of all this, they are the only company in the world right now that can make profit by selling electric vehicle. So it's just imagine in terms of battery, it's like you can use, you can basically playing your Netflix on your phone or playing YouTube, listening to Mintex tutorial on your phone, right? For long hours. Maybe my phone, I can only use, if my phone is Porsche, I can only spend like 3 hours, I can only listen to three of Mintex tutorials. If let's say I use a Tesla, maybe I can watch 7 of Mintex tutorials, that kind of thing. That is the analogy of core efficiency rating in terms of the battery. Okay, next, what is basically the competitive advantage of Tesla? Number one is that they are vertically integrated. Means every single thing from the body to the wires to the batteries, every single thing from Tesla is basically created in-house. Okay, and now, because they created everything in-house, they are now having an economies of scale. Because they own their own battery, they bring down their own costs. And they know what is the best price for the consumer while still making a profit. All the other cars, it's not like that. For instance, a Porsche. A Porsche, maybe they buy their own part I mean, they make their own parts, but they need to buy their battery from somewhere else, maybe a Panasonic or a Samsung or something like that. And because of all this kind of like integration, it makes the cost a lot more, it makes the cost a lot higher. Alright? So basically, the battery business in Tesla is their main competitive advantage. Next, now this is something that I don't know whether everybody knows about this, but you know that cars now can drive itself. Do you guys know that? You know that in US, you just go YouTube, right? YouTube autonomous driving is basically cars driving by itself. You don't even need to touch the steering wheel, the cars will drive by itself. That is the next level of technology. That is basically what is going to happen in the world. Maybe not in Malaysia, maybe in Malaysia in 5-10 years, I don't know. But in the US, it's already happening now. Okay? So, Tesla is the leader in autonomous driving. Why? People, you know, like nowadays, people buy this counter called Uber. People buy the counter Uber, it's not because of their like e-hailing, but they feel like Uber has kind of like a technology to be the leader in autonomous driving, but they are basically totally wrong. Because Tesla is the only car company in the world that owns their own computer chip. Okay? Other competitors in self-driving, like your Uber, like your Apple, like your Google, they don't even have their own chip. They still use chips from NVIDIA, which is basically designed for gaming. Alright? And Tesla, in a Tesla car, there are 8 cameras. There are 8 cameras and basically radars to be there to take data inside, to learn and to kind of like create this sort of like artificial intelligence so that the car can drive by itself safely, even safer than humans. Because imagine, humans only have 2 eyes. Sometimes you drive, you have your 2 eyes, right? But somehow these people drive with like watching some drama at the side, so you practically only drive with one eye. Basically, Tesla car has 8 eyes. You know what I'm saying? So yeah. And basically, why they are also ahead in the competition with regards to autonomous driving is that data is the new oil. Okay, maybe it's a bad analogy because since oil is like so shit, oil is like so dumb right now, but data is basically the new oil. And Tesla is the leader in terms of getting getting like miles in terms of data for self-driving. Okay, right now on the road in the US and globally, Tesla have 1 million cars globally. And 1 million cars that is being driven to collect these miles of data. And the more miles data they have, the more efficient and the more accurate they are going to be in the self-driving technology. So, as you can see over here, right, Tesla in 2020 is going to collect 2.3 billion miles. And their closest competitor, which is Waymo, is only going to probably collect 10 million. 2 billion, 10 billion. That is a big difference in terms of their competitive advantage in autonomous driving. So when there are more and more cars, there will be more and more miles. And it is basically to perfect this kind of like self-driving technology. Another difference also in terms of autonomous driving, Waymo is actually paying $200,000 to assemble a car to collect this data miles, right? They have their ugly radar up there, and I don't know, this is not even like an electric vehicle, it's probably a hybrid car and whatnot, right? They pay like $200,000 to assemble and make one ugly car, okay? While Tesla is getting paid $40,000. So now let's go to the boring part, which is the financials, right? Okay, do you know that Tesla, since the moment they are listed in 2011 until now, they have grown their revenue from 200 million to 25 billion in revenue. That is 82% of compounded annual growth rate. Now, people might say, yeah, but maybe you start from zero, but you do not start from zero. You start from 200 million US dollars in terms of revenue. How many people here knows of companies that generate 200 million US dollars of revenue? Not a lot. And to grow from 200 million US dollars of revenue to then 25 billion is no small feat, right? And now I'm coming to the profit. I also need to tell you that Tesla has never made money in a single kind of like calendar year, in a single financial year. But in the past 6 quarters, they have been profitable 4 times. So what I'm trying to say is that the paradigm has shifted about the Tesla's business model. So I personally invested Tesla here. When I see this, I'm like, okay, it's probably now, finally, they have probably turned the corner. It's basically the Apple moment. You know? So I started buying here, and I've been holding it until now. Okay, now, another thing that we need to compare, the revenue is 82% of CAGR, right? In the span 2011 to 2019. If I compare it to your best ever technology stocks in the world, to your FANG, Tesla still beats all of it. Tesla beats your Facebook, Netflix, Amazon, Google, Apple in terms of revenue growth. They are growing at 82%, the others are growing very low. If I compare Tesla with all the other auto companies, right, from your Volkswagen to your Toyota to your Ford to your GM, it's not even comparable. It's actually laughable in terms of revenue growth. Tesla is also the only company now that whenever they release a new model, it is sold out. It has like crazy long queue for them to basically fulfill. Demand is never a problem for Tesla. The only problem for Tesla is now they cannot deliver the production. It's just production. How much they can supply to fulfill the demand. The demand is just way overboard. The waiting list is just way, way too much. That is Tesla's problem. How can they manufacture fast enough for them to fulfill the demand? And that is the best kind of like problem we have. It's just like right now, coronavirus. Okay, so just a little bit of detail on myself. I own like a hygiene company in Malaysia, right? So right now, I also sell things like hand sanitizer. Right now, I cannot fulfill everybody who wants hand sanitizer. I can't even fulfill it. Like, I need to order my hand sanitizer to sell everybody. It's like, that is kind of like the problems that you want, right? Okay, next, Elon Musk. Why I invest in Tesla is because of Elon Musk, for sure. It's one of the reasons why I invest in Tesla. Why? Who is Elon Musk? Elon Musk is simply, you can just think of him as the real world Tony Stark, the real world Iron Man, right? That's how I view him. He's basically one of the smartest guys alive today, alright? Please Google him if you don't know his background. He's the founder of PayPal. Most of you will know what PayPal is. He's the founder of PayPal, right? And Elon Musk is the only car company CEO that takes $0 for salary. Even our prime minister takes some money, some salary, right? Elon Musk takes zero salary. No other automotive CEO does that. And he is heavily incentivized for Tesla shares to go up. So in 2018, there is like a CEO compensation scheme, which is extremely complex. All right. An example of that complexity is that apparently, if Tesla market cap is to be 100 billion over a period of 6 months without it going below 100 billion, that is the only time that you can get a 2 billion package. All right. And basically, Elon Musk's net worth is all tied up to Tesla. Most of it is tied up to Tesla, a little bit on SpaceX, but mainly is on Tesla. And therefore, in summary, Tesla has to massively increase its sales and profits while also becoming one of the most valuable corporations in the US market in order for Elon Musk to get paid. I don't find any other CEO in the world who does that. Alright? It's basically saying that Elon Musk is saying that pay me only get that, and he himself is also highly marketable. Do you know that Tesla actually spent $0 on marketing? They have never spent on advertising marketing. It has always been free marketing, either from their fans and community or from Elon Musk himself. Do you guys know about the Cybertruck recently? Anybody watch the Cybertruck and how everybody is laughing at it like, oh, this is like a disaster kind of like thing? But do you know that the Cybertruck and the disaster that happened when the window cracked, it went viral and it's probably, if kind of like other companies wishes to get the virality of that particular presentation, they would have paid millions, right?
but Elon Musk does it, Tesla does it for free. Okay, that's how cool it is. Next, the future. What is the future for Tesla, right? What are the opportunities and what is basically, where is the growth area for this founder? The first one is that, okay, do you know that globally, worldwide, in a single year, there is 90 million cars that is being sold. And only 2% of that is electric vehicle. What I'm saying is that now globally, people are still buying combustion engine cars. People are still burning fossil fuels. People are still making the environmental a lousier place. All right? So from 2% to out of 100%, there is a huge opportunity over there. And they have also unveiled like Model Y, the Tesla Semi-Truck, the Tesla Cybertruck, and recently Gigafactory is already running, right, as of, I think, November last year. Do you guys know that in building the Gigafactory, Tesla only spent about 10 months from it being a hill until it being a Gigafactory, they only spent 10 months of production. That's crazy. And of course, the future is robotaxi. So what is robotaxi? So the story is that in the future, if you own a Tesla car, you know, when you park your car and you go home and you kind of like take shower, you have your dinner, you can choose to say, okay Tesla, you can go and be my Uber. You know, then the Tesla will go around themselves, pick up people and bring the people to the location. So they become the Uber. That is basically a robotaxi, right? And what it is trying to target is basically, you know, just like the ride sharing app Uber, right? So these are all kind of like the future for Tesla. They have like the best range of EV, again as mentioned. They are the leader in autonomous driving. They are probably going to be there the first. And they have all these things lined up for in terms of their growth. And not only that, Tesla also owns like in energy business. You know, they develop this kind of like, okay, when you guys think about renewable energy, what do you guys think of? Wind farm, solar farm, but nobody, hydro, right? But nobody actually thinks about batteries as a means of renewable energy, but it is. In Australia, they are already using Tesla batteries to kind of like power up the whole city, you know? And solar roof, basically, basically having kind of like cutting costs and getting money from just having solar on top of your roof. That is basically their energy business. And in 2019, this business gives them 1.5 million in revenue. So now, let's just do a rough, kind of like a back of the napkin, back of the paper kind of like valuation, all right? Back of paper, napkin math valuation, maybe say 3 years from now, what should be a fair value of Tesla? Let's just kind of like do that calculation. Simple mathematics, all right? And I'm only going to do only on the automotive segment. I'm going to ignore their autonomous driving, robot taxi, and their energy. So by 2022, maybe, you know, like in the beginning, as I mentioned, Tesla has already given, I mean, this 2019, they produced 337,000 of cars. They make and they sell 337,000 of cars. They say this year is going to be 500,000, 2020. I assume that in 2022, they can make and deliver 1 million cars. Why? Because Gigafactory Shanghai is there. They are building a Gigafactory in Berlin. And now their Gigafactory in the US is also getting more and more efficient. Alright, so I think they can reach 1 million cars. That is my assumption. And I'm going to say that average selling price is going to be at 50,000. It's a mix between the Model 3, which is selling at about 30,000-40,000. And all the other cars that are selling a little bit, about 18,000 to 120,000. So I just say average selling price is 50,000. So this comes up with a revenue of 50 billion. I'm just going to assume a 25% gross margin. Okay, so gross profit will be about 12.5 billion. So in 2019, Tesla had a rough operational expenses of about 1 billion per quarter. Now I'm going to make it, maybe let's just assume it's going to be 1.5 billion per quarter in 3 years' time. So operating profit is going to be 6.5 times. I'm gonna also assume and give it a valuation of operating profit multiplied by 30. So that gives me a market cap valuation of 200 billion. Of course, this is just a very, very simple back of paper napkin math in terms of me calculating the value. But in 3 years' time, this is how I feel like the fair value of Tesla. Very simple type. And it's basically 200 billion. It's double your investment if you buy it today, right? I didn't know that you raised that. I didn't know your point. Okay, so now the question is, what about the next decade? Maybe in 3 years' time, yeah, it seems possible, but what about in the next 10 years? Is it possible for Tesla to sell 6 million cars? And could they be the one that is going to take over Uber's revenue? Uber right now has about, if I'm not mistaken, 4 million drivers globally. So maybe in 2030, I don't think that it is easily there, right? There will definitely be more than 4 million Tesla cars driving. Because in a year, you're already going to make 6 million cars. So it's definitely more than 12 million revenue. But for simplicity's sake, say that the robotaxi is only going to take about 12 million of revenue. And also, maybe, you know, their energy business is going to give 50 billion of revenue. So Tesla's revenue in 10 years may be about 300 to 400 billion US dollars. If it's yes, then, you know, right now, on average, historical average, Tesla's valuation has always been on price to sales ratio of about 6 or 7 times. If the revenue is at 365 billion in 2030, then it should easily be a $1 trillion company. So this is Tesla's road to $1 trillion. Do I personally think that it can go to $1 trillion? I think yes, in the next decade. So, yeah. And finally, I'm just going to end on Tesla, is that investing in Tesla is more than just making money. You are actually also giving a shot to the global climate crisis. Right, bringing the world off fossil fuels, and this is basically Tesla's mission statement, to accelerate the world's transition to sustainable energy. So that's Tesla, so please keep that in your mind, take a look at it. I haven't talked about the risk of investing in Tesla. There are definitely a lot of risks investing in Tesla, but maybe that's another time. But what I just shared with you is why I think Tesla is my champion of the generational stock. So now, I'm going to move into basically stability in the portfolio, right? So as Mingtek had mentioned to you guys, I have this startup company called Stockbit. And basically Stockbit is like your KLIT investor in Malaysia. I mean, everybody here is a Malaysian investor trader, right? I mean, you guys trade in Malaysian market, right? And I'm sure you guys know about like all these KLIT investors and all, right? Okay. So basically, Stockbit also runs something like that. We are a social networking platform. We are here, has been for about 1.5 years. But so in Stockbit recently, this is just a few days ago when the whole entire market is in collapse. So this guy basically said, hey guys, you know, is there any suggestions about some stocks or investments that you can just buy and hold and not really have to think, monitor, or analyze it every day? While getting reasonable returns, say about 5-10% a year, I say yes, for sure there is such thing. You know? Personally, for me, I invested in this counter in Malaysia called Atrium REIT. It's a REIT. So I'm just going to assume that everybody here knows what a REIT is. But Atrium REIT is actually one of my top picks for 2020. Actually, at the beginning of the year in Stockbit, I asked everybody what are their top 5 picks for the year. So Atrium REIT is actually one of my top picks because for me it just makes sense. During that time, S&P 500 was an all-time high. Malaysia economy was lousy. Interest rate was low and it's only going to get lower. So I thought, why not I buy Atrium REIT? And Atrium REIT actually has, I mean, the public has kind of like a misconception about this particular company. And I thought that it was a good opportunity to start buying Atrium REIT. Why? I'll share with you why. So first, what is the competitive advantage of Atrium? Okay. So Atrium is actually the first industrial property focused within Malaysia. Industrial property focused within Malaysia. Okay? And it is still the purest industrial warehouse property exposure on Bursa Malaysia. So a lot of their rental income, it comes basically their tenants are like the international manufacturers or the logistic MNC players. And all 8 industrial properties are all fully tenanted. And basically, industrial, you guys have to imagine this now. What are the sort of REITs? Can you guys name me a REIT that you know? IGB REIT, right? So what does IGB REIT do? What do they own? Maybe Valley Gardens, right? Pavilion REIT, what do they own? Shopping malls? What other REITs? Sunway REIT, yeah. So all these REITs, they might have shopping malls or some retail shops or whatever, but Atrium REIT, what they own is they own industrial lots. Okay, industrial lots that is tenanted 100%. I mean, all of their assets is being tenanted to somebody. And each of their particular rental, each of their tenants have a 3% rental increment every single year. It means they have to pay more to Atrium every single year. Alright? So now their dividend per unit has been increasing and will increase further with new property that had been onboarded at the end of last year. So it's also managed by experienced professional manager, the founder, blah blah blah. You know, they have been it's quite experienced. Okay, so now one of the advantage of basically investing in Malaysia, your local home country, as compared to like investing in foreign country like US, is that you have access to management. So I personally have seen the management of Atrium, and I can tell you that they are actually pretty cool people, and you know they are solid people basically. All right. Okay. Another investment thesis is that we are at the moment at low interest rate environment in Malaysia. Okay. In 2020, the Bank Negara in itself has cut the interest rate 2 times. Alright? It is now at OPR rate of 2.5%. And it is expected to be cut further. Alright? KWSB, right, last time used to pay you like 8% dividend to the Bumi Putra, now only paying 5% dividend. Okay? And I mean, I'm not an Indonesian, okay, so I'm not really involved in the Malaysian politics scene, but Malaysian politics is really bad, right? And you know, it's actually very laughable. And all this like political turmoil in Malaysia, they could actually lead to credit rating agency cutting the sovereign rating of Malaysia bonds, right? And that is very bad. Also, coronavirus right now is actually going to impact a lot of the Malaysian companies, risking a lower dividend payout in 2020 across the board. Maybe you can last time you used to talk about your Yuchi technology or something like that pays you like 5-6% dividend yield every single year. Maybe now because coronavirus, their results are now going to be lousy, they're only going to pay you like what, 3-4% of dividend, I don't know. But there is that risk that they're going to pay a lower dividend this year than last year. Also, coronavirus might impact performance of some REITs, like in the hospitality and retail segments. Those REITs that depend themselves on, for instance, tourists that come in, or those REITs that depend themselves on people that goes into their shopping mall, those REITs might get impacted in terms of their distribution payment, but not Asian REITs. Why? Because all of their assets is already fully tenanted. So they have, as I mentioned just now, they have they have 6 assets. Okay, first is Atrium Shah Alam. It is basically leased to this guy. And then they have Shah Alam 2, leased to Samsung. And then Shah Alam 3, leased to another logistic player. And in Hujung, leased to this fella. In USJ, it is listed to these 3 guys. Alright? So now, this is basically the particular kind of like the tenure of their rental. So as you can see, all of them is fully tenanted. This one and this one, because this is a 2019 presentation, so I know that these three have actually kind of like extended their lease for another 2 to 4 years. So now all of this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, all of them fully tenanted. Alright, so every single month in June week without fail will get rental income. Now, last year Atrium REIT actually made something that is basically growing their portfolio. They bought over two factories, two industrial properties in Penang. And those two factories are Plant 1 and Plant 2 of Lumilab buildings. Okay? And right now, Lumilab is still renting this space. They have a 15 years contract. So that is basically what happened. The latest financials of basically Q4 2019, what happened is that now we are actually seeing that particular acquisition of this is already here. As you can see that the gross revenue of last quarter has already increased. Okay, what were the prospects? Occupancy rate for the trust portfolio properties, 100%. See, 100%. Right? So all of them are tenanted. This is not like a shopping mall REIT or your hospitality REIT that depends on people walking into their particular properties. These properties, as long as they are tenanted, they are going to get your revenue 100%. Manager also expect trust performance to improve in the next financial year as Lumilab will contribute, and two proposed property acquisitions are expected to also contribute positively when acquisitions are completed. So, and this is basically the piece. And then, so basically what I'm trying to say is that from last year to this year, the revenue of Atrium REIT is going to go up and the dividend distribution is going to go up as well. So Atrium REIT, there is a decent amount of long-term investors. This guy, Hong Leong Assurance, these guys are basically together with him, some funds. Right, and these guys are also kind of like his buddies. Chua Simon is the son of this guy called Chua Mayu or someone. And then these are another kind of like institutions. So these guys in the top 20, most of them are long-term shareholders. I don't know who these guys are, but most of them are long-term shareholders. So what I want to encourage you all is that this is Atrium REIT's price over the past 5 years. Actually, as of last year, it was trading at about 1.24 before it dropped. Why is there a drop here? There's a drop here because Atrium REIT announced the rights issue. I knew about the rights issue. I personally invested in Atrium REIT earlier in the year. I was basically proposed for a private placement in Atrium REIT. I entered into the Atrium REIT. Okay, and basically I saw it goes up, I saw it come down. I'm still holding Atrium REIT. So why was the drop? It's because they announced there was going to be a rights issue. They raised money for this Atrium to actually purchase the Penang property. Right? They were raising funds. So is that actually a bad thing? The market, in Malaysian market, every time you announce rights issue, everything just sell off. They don't even know what this rights issue is all about. Rights issue means bad stuff. Okay, so that's Malaysian mentality. They don't really see the long, I mean, basically like the bigger picture. That's what I'm trying to say. So they were actually, they were probably afraid that, you know, there is going to be a drop in the distribution per share. And it did. The distribution per share actually did drop last year because of this particular acquisition. But it's basically, you're doing something bad now for the good of your future. Why would you want to sell? Why do you want to find the market, right? But now, as you guys see, things are starting to normalize already, and the distribution per share has actually increased. So this year, we are expecting actually a 9-cent dividend for the full year 2020. This has been confirmed by the management as well.
this number should be around the dollar figure, either this or gonna be even higher. Alright? And hopefully the price might actually start to climb back up. But obviously because of the coronavirus, you can see over here, right? People are starting to like think, hey, actually now the Malaysian market interest rate also low, I put in IP also, I'm not gonna get anything. Probably inflation is higher than my fixed deposit, what should I buy? They look into REITs, all the REITs they look, then they realize, oh, it can be so good. So maybe some of them has been buying it, they went up to 1.1. But obviously because of coronavirus it's back down to 1.8. So I would think that at this particular rate, you're buying a counter that is gonna give you a 9-cent dividend. I don't think it's a bad idea. It's a 9% dividend yield for this particular counter. And mind you again, across the board in Malaysia, you're probably going to see a lower interest rate environment. So holding REIT, you know, it is never the wrong move in the long term. As this guy mentioned, the 3%, it says that if you hold all Malaysian REITs from your IPO, everything is going up. So Atrium REIT obviously is not very sexy, it's probably around here, but it could be because it is still misunderstood by the market. The market don't really appreciate what it's trying to do. Okay, so this is basically the live daily update, right? What they do is that they take the total dividends of the last 4 months and find out what is basically their yield. But that is wrong because obviously the past 4 months, the Atrium REIT is giving a very low dividends, right? But this year, from this year onwards, this is basically not going to be only this. This is not going to be at this. It's going to give you a 9 cents dividend, and 9 cents dividend it will bring the GMV around here. Okay. What I'm going to end my kind of my presentation here is this particular quote that I love. This is my all-time favorite quote. I use it everywhere. Okay. So I think the key in investing, in a generational stock or a stock that gives you a stable, defensive return, right, is that you need to focus on buying companies when they are out of favor. So like Tesla last year, it was out of favor. Alright, that is when either because the general market condition or because the financial community at the moment has misconceptions or just do not understand the true worth of the stock. And therefore, the stock is selling at prices well under what it will be when the market understands its true value. So Tesla actually had that. Tesla was misunderstood for the longest time, you know? Like ever since last year, it was misunderstood for the longest time. It went to 170 something US dollars. But when finally the market realizes its true value, it went all the way up to 970 or 950, I forgot. That is basically when the market appreciates what it's offering. Right now, Tesla is around 500 because of the coronavirus. Does the coronavirus actually impact Tesla? Maybe in the supply chain, but I don't think the future it impacts Tesla in any way. So yeah, I guess that's where I'm going to end my presentation on these two. But I would like to also just give a shout out to basically Stockbit, because Stockbit is basically kind of like a startup of my own. It's an Indonesian fintech startup, alright? What it is a social networking platform for stock investors. It is the KLI3 of Indonesia retailers. It has the biggest community of retail in Indonesia. Okay? And we actually launched in Malaysia about November 2018. We went live then. So what we're trying to do is that we basically try and to level the investment playing field with institutions and also retailers, right? And in Malaysia, we all know that there are basically KLSB Screener and also KLIB Investor. Those are basically where everybody use app or basically a place where they trade ideas. But the thing is, KLIB is a forum. Forums are 1990s technology. Forums do not let you control what you want to see, right? We are doing social media technology. You can see LinkedIn here, right? LinkedIn.
So, for instance, you like Nitek, you go to him, you follow him.
You only follow him.
You find some Tom, Dick and Harry who talk about nonsense all the time. Unlike in Galaxy where you have to weigh all his nonsense, over here you just block it. Right? So that's basically the good main the pros of social media technology. You can do technical analysis for your mobile, you can put all your stocks in your watch list. You can also, whenever you follow a stock and there's a news from the start of the age, it will pop up. And then you get stocks information from the homepage, from the stream. Okay, and we have some unique features like seasonality where you actually kind of like know which stock is going to go up in a particular month. So for instance, like in the month of March, apparently in the past 10 years, Supermax has always had a down month and all that. So yeah, you know these sort of things. And then there's like the financials, you can actually have some fun with like target prices. There's basically all these hashtags. So for instance, instead of a hashtag, you kind of like hashtag the company. Say you want to talk about AGM, you can hashtag AGM. So your post will forever be in the AGM stage. You can do some polling. Okay, you can check out some key statistics. You can basically have your mode, whether it's going to be light or dark mode. You have your price alerts. So just check Stockbit out. To be honest, Stockbit in the past how many years that we have been in Malaysia, we have not really focused on developing it for the Malaysian market, but that is going to change hopefully this year, because Stockbit as an entity, we actually have just closed our Series B funding, and some of that funding is already committed for us to actually really focus on our Malaysian market. So we are really going to try and implement and improve the features in the Malaysian market, so it's as good as it can be in the Indonesian market. Some of the things that is in the Indonesian market that is not in the Malaysian market are things like screeners, also like historical PE ratio. You know, sometimes when people talk about fundamental analysis, you do this thing called a peers valuation. You compare this counter with this counter and this counter and this counter, and which one has basically the lowest PE ratio. So that is important, but at the same time, it is also important to see what is the company's historical PE ratio. Because in Malaysia, there are a lot of value traps. So there are companies that are trading at like 5 times PE ratio, 6 times PE ratio. You might think, oh, this is bloody cheap. But actually, if you do like a PE ratio over the past 10, 20 years, your average PE ratio is 6 times. Then it basically is not undervalued. It's basically, this is a value trap. Basically, maybe it's owned by a family, and the family just doesn't want this particular stock to go up. So there's no point of you investing in such a lousy company. It's a value trap, just check yourself. Okay? So these are the sort of like features that will be available to the Malaysian market. As and when we really going to ramp up our production here and our development here in Malaysia. So yeah, with that will end my presentation.